Nailed it. All right. Good morning, everybody, or good afternoon. How's everyone doing? Great. Awesome. Thank you. So I'm really pumped to be here, and I'm so excited to be able to follow Dr. Muhammad. I was joking to Kathy and to a few other folks that he's from Detroit. I'm from Chicago. We could probably drive to go see each other in less time than it took for us to get here, definitely. But I had to come all the way to Sydney, Australia to see this amazing mind. So thank you, Dr. Muhammad, for what you shared. And I was joking to him in the car ride the whole way here that I was just going to copy his keynote. But I think I'm actually going to just borrow your slides and do the same thing. All right. This isn't my first time here in Australia. I'm really excited to be here for a lot of reasons. I got to go to Bondi Beach for the first time, though, this time. And it was super exciting for me because this is what it looked like in Chicago last year at this time. Now, you know, we had to shut down Chicago public schools because it got to negative 40 degree wind chills. And when I asked folks here, does it snow, they laughed at me, first of all. And then when I asked, what is negative 40 in Celsius, because it was negative 40 Fahrenheit, and fun fact, friends, if you haven't learned anything yet today, negative 40 degrees is where Celsius and Fahrenheit meet. So negative 40 Fahrenheit is also negative 40 Celsius. It's, in layman's terms, that's real cold. Now, going to Bondi Beach and being here in Australia this time has been such a thrill for me, not only because I've gotten out of the terrible frozen tundra that is Chicago, Illinois, but also because I got to bring my husband, that's Jim, and today while I'm here, I said, honey, don't you want to come see me do a talk about education, and we could talk about changing the world, and he said, no. I said, what are you going to do instead? And he's going to do the Sydney Harbor Bridge Walk. And I said, oh, that sounds great. And he said, well, honey, don't you want to come? And I said, no. And he said, well, what types of things do you want to do while we're in Australia? And I said, you know, all the normal tourist things, eat and drink. So we did do that. We went to Mr. Crackle's. We got to have a nice, lovely beer and wine. But the thing is that, you know, I'm spending all my time eating instead of doing this. And what's really funny also about that is I'm eating and not doing anything athletic, but they brought me in through the athlete's entry this morning. Ha, fooled you. But here's the thing. The reason that I'm not doing the Sydney Harbor Bridge Walk, and I didn't ask my husband to wait for me and to say, let's experience this miraculous thing together, is not because I don't think it would be an amazing experience. I mean, the selfie opportunity alone would be totally worth it. The real reason that I'm not doing it is because I think I can't. I am terrified of heights. I think that I would be the like hold up at the top of the bridge. I'd get there and I'd be like, what have I done? And they'd have to like helicopter me down from the top. And every time my husband was spending last night trying to convince me, saying, I can wait, we could do it this evening, it'll be so romantic. Every excuse he had, I said, yes, but I can't. And as I heard myself talking, I also realized that I was using a lot of negative language. And as an educator, this is exactly what we're trying to stop. And as you're here today at Inspire Innovate New South Wales, one of the things that we're trying to do here as leading from the front, as you heard earlier, is changing that yes but into that yes and mentality. And so today what I want to chat with you a bit for the next 40 or so minutes is that concept of saying, I can't do it, yes, but, and changing it to a yes, and more importantly, my favorite phrase in the world, which is, and what if? And as a teacher, we don't hear that a whole lot. On May 25th, 1961, John F. Kennedy, the US president at the time, we won't get into the current US president politics stuff happening right now. I think every single Uber I've gotten into since I've arrived in Australia, they're like personally blaming me for Donald Trump. Because I have an American accent. I'm like, dude, I'm a teacher. I am not voting for that guy. But anyway, you know, John F. Kennedy on May 25th, 1961, gave this really famous talk. And it was all about challenging the US Congress to do something completely wacko and impossible, which was sending a man to the moon. And in the 60s, for you to say something like that was like saying, you know, I want for you to, you know, go live on Mars. Actually, that's possible now too. And what if, am I right? So that idea was then dubbed moonshot, and that whole speech was called shooting for the moon, or doing something that you think is impossible, but we actually did, unless you're a conspiracy theorist and you don't believe it. Now, Google has created an entire organization around that concept of moonshot, and that's Google X, which is their super secret, not so secret because we all know about it, research development wing that just tries to think about impossible things and make them happen. The self-driving car, Google Glass, all of those are part of their Google X Moonshot Lab. And to inspire engineers and scientists from across the world to join hands with them and take part in this, they created a video all around moonshots and what it means to be a moonshot thinker. They meant to recruit scientists who are full-grown, full-size, but this video has made it in its way into American school systems. And I was at a conference just like you, sitting there listening to someone talk at me just like you, and I was checking my email, just like some of you. And then they played this video. And for the first time that day, I closed my laptop. I stopped looking at the emails from angry parents. I put away the math exams that I was grading. And I looked up and I thought, huh. And I realized that there were a lot of mantras that were being said by the scientists in the video that really resonated well with me. And I thought I could bring them back to my year fours and year fives. And so what I want to do for you is what I did with my students when I brought this video back into my classroom. I said, boys and girls, I want you to watch this video. And I want you to think of things that are really speaking to you, things that make you go, huh, or yeah. And I want you to find a moonshot mantra. I asked them to take out a piece of paper and a pen, which was totally crazy in my classroom because we were one-to-one. They were like, what's a piece of paper, Miss Magiera? So I gave them these foreign technology tools called pencils, and I had them write down a list of things that the scientists were saying in this video that made them think a little differently, and I'm going to give you that same challenge. So go ahead and take out, I see that they have very generously provided you today with complimentary paper and pens. And I want you to do this on paper because I want you to have the ability to doodle, to draw, to underline words. Sometimes the tangible technology can be more powerful than digital. And as you listen to this, I want you to write down any phrases that stick out to you. Here we go.
The actual moonshot is wonderful, inspirational, poetic, beautiful, involved great technical challenges, genuine heroism. It brought the world together. But think about the Polynesian Islander on the dugout canoe, deciding one day they were going to go that way. No one had ever been that way before. No one even knew if there was anything that way before. It was amazing, and it changed the world.
People can set their minds to magical, seemingly impossible ideas, and then through science and technology, bring them to reality. And that then sets other people on fire that other things that look impossible might be accomplishable.
Galileo is such a hero, you know, in thinking big. And what he represents to me is both curiosity and wonder that humanity had, that he had, that pushed him and drove himself to invent and work on the first telescopes that allowed us to see the moon, and here we are.
These aviation pioneers were figuring it out as they went. No one really knew how to build an airplane, right? No one knew how to fly an airplane. It was amazing and crazy and wonderful, and they wanted to explore.
Many years ago, the great British explorer George Mallory, who was to die on Mount Everest, was asked, why did he want to climb it? He said, because it is there.
There's so many challenges in the world, and you can feel daunted by that, you know, and sort of oppressed by that, or you kind of say, how might we think differently about this?
Everyone else in the world is working on the next 10%. If you can be the one that delivers that 10 times improvement, you have a chance to really change things.
If you want cars to run at 50 miles per gallon, fine, you can retool your car a little bit. But if I tell you it has to run on a gallon of gas for 500 miles, you have to start over.
you need a lot of courage in this work, and you need a lot of persistence. One of the things that's really critical is not only having the courage to keep drawing every day or thinking big, even if you don't really 100% believe it's possible, like you might think this might be possible, have the courage to try. That's how the greatest things have happened.
You don't spend your time being bothered that you can't teleport from here to Japan, because there's a part of you that thinks it's impossible. Moonshot thinking is choosing to be bothered by that.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Humanity's progress has been a series of amazing, audacious things, from the very small and personal up to the great, big, and grand. And we are a species of moonshots. And to me, that's like the really amazing, poetic, and inspirational thing.
I think our ambitions are a glass ceiling on what we can accomplish.
When you find your passion, you're unstoppable. You can make amazing things happen. It's been true through all of history.
I believe in the human spirit, and I believe that there are always going to be crazy people who will get out of bed one morning and say, you know what? I think I can build a space elevator, and let's go and do it. But I think that if we become afraid to take these great big risks, we stop inspiring people. We stop achieving things. And the biggest nightmare scenario is that we won't have what it takes to solve the really big challenges.
When Kennedy said that we would put a man on the moon, it's about the fact that he said, we don't know how to do this yet, and we're gonna do it anyway. And that sends chills up everybody's spine. Because if that happens, what couldn't we do?
So I've seen this video a million times. I've shown it to every group of kids I've taught for the past couple years. I've shown it to principals, superintendents, to teachers around the world. And I'm always really amazed by the passion they have in their voices. And I hope that some of you had some of these phrases resonate with you. Just shouting out, can anyone say, like, what was something that you heard in the video that you might write down or get tattooed on your back?
Be bothered to try.
Be bothered to try. What else? Find your passion. Is there someone over there?
If we stop taking risks, we stop achieving.
If we stop taking risks, we stop achieving. I love this. There's so many things. My students filled papers and papers. They actually ended up creating their own designs for things that they were going to press onto their lockers. And mom and dad that I recommended that. But one of our favorite phrases that came out of this, and for me, sitting in that audience of Chicago Public Schools teachers and looking up and having a moment of, wow, was this phrase.
You don't spend your time being bothered that you can't teleport from here to Japan, because there's a part of you that thinks it's impossible. Moonshot thinking is choosing to be bothered by that.
Choosing to be bothered. As educators, there are so many things that are frustrating. For those of you who are here for Dr. Muhammad's brilliant workshop just previous to this, he talked about, what was the Aussie word for venting or complaining? Wedging? Whinging. Whinging? Whinging. I'm gonna have to get a spelling on that. Could someone tweet that for me? Whinging. He talked about all the things that we're whinging about in your staff lounges. And I don't think, obviously, that's not unique to Aussie educators. In the US, we just call it something different. We won't get into that word. But anyway, the idea is that there's so many things that we're being told we cannot do. You cannot do because of finances, because of time, because of resources, because of the demographic of students that you teach. But choosing to be bothered by that is something that we lose as teachers. After a while, we say, we can't do that. I'm just a teacher. I can't change it, so I'm not going to be bothered by it. But choosing to be bothered is a really powerful psychological stance to take. Now, thinking about all the mantras that you wrote down on your paper, I want you to right now to really think about that, and I want to take it a step further, because as educators, we know that if you ask your kids to do something independently, they may or may not do it, but ask them to pair up and talk to someone else, and there's a higher level of accountability. But I want to take that a step further than that. How many of you came with someone you know today? How many of you are sitting at the same table as them? Yeah, teachers are like high school students. You get to the cafeteria and you're like, hey, you're my friend, I'm gonna sit next to you, and you're afraid to talk to anyone else because they might think that you're lame. what happens when we come to these conferences is we stick to our herds and our silos. But as you heard your executive director was saying in the opening, connectedness and collaboration is what makes us truly powerful. And so I'd like for you to get out of your silo and your comfort zone, and I'd like for you to make awkward eye contact with someone you don't know right now. Like, no one will look at me. This is weird. All right. And bonus points if they're at a different table. Now, here's the thing. We go to these conferences, we stick with our friends, but you are missing out on an opportunity because your edu soulmate may be on the other side of the room, that person who understands you. Remember Dr. Muhammad said if we had that, like, what did you say, the love-o-meter earlier? Like, they might, like, have your edu love. Like, I get you, girl. I know what you're talking about. I'm picking up what you're putting down. And they might have the solutions to the challenges that you're whinging about in your staff rooms. So I challenge you to get up right now. Go find somebody who you don't know. Introduce yourselves and share your moonshot mantra. But wait, there's more. Once you share your moonshot mantra, we need to commemorate this moment of you meeting your edu soulmate for the first time, because you're going to go and make edu magic together. So to do that, we're going to use a 21st century tool called a selfie. And so what I'd like for you to do is introduce yourself to someone you don't know, share your moonshot mantra, determine which one you both can settle on, and then tweet it out with a selfie using the hashtag InspireNSW. Now, if you want to go for like the highest level of badging, you can do an Asian style selfie, which means put a peace sign by your eye. I can say that because I'm Asian. And tweet that out. You guys ready? On your marks, get set, go. All right, just take another minute. All right, brilliantly done. Go ahead, give your new bestie a high five, a fist bump, a shaka, and a... come on back to your seats.
I can't do that and hold the camera. That's too hard. Hold on, now.
There you go.
Okay.
Nice. All right, friends, so come on back to your seats. I really hope that you got to meet someone brand new. If you didn't get a chance to meet someone new, just walk up to someone in the hallway today and say, hey, can we take a selfie? It'll be totally okay to do now. You know, as you're tweeting out these mantras, and for those of you who aren't on the Twitters yet, the session after lunch that I'm doing is about social media in school, so come on down. But as you're thinking about that, I want to talk to you about one other mantra that has really stuck out to me recently. And that's what we're basing the rest of this talk about. And it's Astroteller, the dude with the goatee in the talk, in the video, says, our ambitions are a glass ceiling in what we can accomplish. And as teachers, I think that that's something we really need to think about, both in our own ambitions as professionals and educators, but also the ambitions that we work and seek out to achieve with our children. I said before that I was going to just repeat all of Dr. Bahamut's keynote, and I didn't lie, so let's go ahead and talk about will and skill. As I was sitting in the audience and listening to Dr. Muhammad, you know, kind of preach the things that really made my heart beat faster, and I was thinking, amen, yes. When he said this point, I really was doing my slow nod. I was like, I'm picking up what he's putting down, will and skill. And when he showed the graphic, I'm a maths teacher, so I love anything that has quadrants. And so I was really excited about this as well. But then one of your own teachers, Eddie Wu, who's a maths teacher here in New South Wales in Sydney. Where's he at, Eddie? Woo-woo, right here. As I was trolling Twitter, I saw that he did a little sketch note, which, you know, actually gave Dr. Muhammad's adorably cheeky Kumbaya University hot mess. We say hot mess in Chicago, too, so I loved that. And as I was thinking about this, I thought, yes, this is true. Our teachers need to have the will to do something, but also the skill to achieve it. And I had a yes and moment. I thought, yes, and I think there's another facet to that that we could add, because Dr. Muhammad's will and skill are very important. And now that I'm leading a school district and for the, you know, coming out of the classroom for the first time, I realized that there's a third dimension to will and skill, and that's courage. A lot of us, many of us in the room probably, have the will. You're here, unless you were voluntold to show up. But you have the will, you think that we can do something different. And hopefully by the end of today and tomorrow, you'll have built some more skill, but do you have the courage to believe you can do so? As we try and navigate our way in that quadrant graphic to high skill, high will, and we're walking our way up, a lot of times that I can't blocks us. That same I can't that kept me from joining my husband on the Harbor Bridge walk. And I can't is built on a foundation of fear and disbelief. I'm too scared, I'll fall off the bridge and die, goodbye forever. Or disbelief. That type of thing, it's for other people, not for me. I can't do it. Other people can do it. I believe that it's safe. I think it's the right thing to do, but not for me. For that teacher down the hall, for that teacher I saw presenting at Inspire Innovate. And so as we think about that block of I can't that helps us achieve where the high will and high skill can take us, think about those ambitions that Astro Teller was talking about and having those higher ambitions. And how can we utilize those ambitions to push back on the fear and disbelief that we have for ourselves and for our children? So I want to tell you three stories today about having those higher ambitions and pushing back on fear and disbelief that come from my own experience as a classroom teacher and from the schools that I work with in Chicago. This was my first class, my first year of teaching, on the south side of Chicago at Cermak and State, and it was a glorious first year. First of all, because I only had like 15 students, which was really talking about, Dr. Muhammad talked about setting people up for failure. This was like mine. I was like, oh, all class sizes are 12 to 15 kids everywhere in the world. This is completely reasonable. Spoiler alert, my last year out of the classroom, I had 40 students in one period, 37 in the second, 16 of whom were identified for individual education programs as special ed students. So this wasn't my situation my whole career, but my first year was quite delightful. And it was delightful not only because I had such a small class, but as a first-year teacher, you guys remember, right, that first class that you had. And even going a step further, do any of you remember in ed school when you were getting your degree that philosophy of education you had to write about what kind of a teacher you wanted to be? Have you read it recently and thought, oh, that's cute? Because I entered my classroom so excited to be spending every weekday with my students, helping them learn, helping them become better versions of themselves. And that happened. I got to be there every single day working with my kids all day, all night. And every weekend I spent every day working with my kids all day, all night. Because again, I was a first-year teacher and I was really trying to figure stuff out. But my philosophy of education was all about helping my kids become better human beings, becoming better citizens of the world. I think I might have actually written something as hubristic as, every child will cure cancer. All of them. But what I actually spent a lot of time doing when I entered the classroom was making anchor charts. Lots and lots of anchor charts. And you guys, Just to brag, I am really good at making anchor charts. I'm so good, and I was so proud of myself that I took a photo of every single anchor chart that I created and sent them home to my parents. Look, Ma, I made it. Place value charts. And I was so excited. I was like, look at my classroom. It's a beautiful environment. I used appropriate handwriting. But the real reason that I made these anchor charts wasn't just because I had this paranormal skill, but also because as a teacher on the south side of Chicago, and for those of you who aren't familiar with the city of Chicago demographics, the south side is that inner city that Dr. Muhammad was talking about earlier, the hood, where 99% of my students qualified as low income and 100% of my students were minorities. The thing that we were told every year was if your kids do not meet annual yearly progress on their state exam, we will shut down your school. And I thought, well, where are the kids gonna go? We can't do that. So I thought, we cannot let our kids fail. Every moment of every day, my job was to prevent failure. Failing the test, failing in that student center, failing on the state exams, and thereby failing at life. So I spent all this time looking over my students' shoulders and helping them be successful, and it wasn't until I actually came to this side of the world that I realized that I had things backwards. I got to visit a school just outside of Auckland, New Zealand, and as I was touring the school, the principal pointed out this sign to me, package free lunch. And I said, what is package free lunch? What does that mean? And he said, oh, it was this big failure that our grade fives had. It was awesome. And I thought, oh, this guy's a monster. He delights in children failure. And I'm like, what's the New Zealand 911? How do I call the police? But really, I prodded him and I thought, you know, what do you mean by fail? Why were you so excited? And he said, Jennie, failure is the stuff that learning is made from. And I went back to the States and I shared this with some friends, and my friend Ken Shelton, who is a teacher out in the Los Angeles area, said, yeah, Jennie, everyone knows that. And again, going back to acronyms, he told me that FAIL isn't actually the lack of success, but it's an acronym for the first attempt in learning. And I thought, oh, I like that. But as I continued talking with the principal at this QE school, I realized that the first attempt in learning is really important, and we rob our children of this far too often. When I'm creating these gads and gads of anchor charts and looking over their shoulders, my thing is I want them to feel successful all the time. Any moment that they have a tiniest hint of cognitive dissonance or confusion, I want them to be able to run to me and know I'll be there for them. And despite all of my best wishes, I am not going to be following these children for the rest of their lives. And they get to go home at night, and they're not always having me following them over their shoulders to support them. And because I'm preventing them from failing, I'm not teaching them how to recover from that failure, which is leading them to even greater failure later in life. So if I let my kids fail, then I'm giving them the opportunity to do the real magic of learning, which is the second attempt in learning. Eh? 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 You see what I did there? You fail, and then you sail. Nailed it. So, when our kids have that second attempt in learning, it's saying to them, not only is failure a good thing, but it allows you to have meaningful iteration. If your kid guesses on something or tries something out and is immediately successful, that is not as powerful or true a learning opportunity as if they fail first, have to pick themselves back up, figure out what didn't go right, and try a second time and succeed then. And there could be third and fourth attempts at learning, tail, fail again. The acronyms aren't as cute. But that second attempt in learning can have incredible exponential outcomes. For example, at that school where they tried to do the package-free lunch, what had happened was the children said, we have way too big of a carbon footprint in the world. Every day, we're bringing so much rubbish and garbage to school, and it's all going into the rubbish bins. We want to have less of that. So they instituted this new program called Package Free Lunch, where they tried to encourage families to stop sending disposable packaging containers in students' lunch pails and instead use reusable containers. They did a whole project-based learning unit about it. They did a campaign. They sent home flyers. And the teachers knew from the beginning that it would not work. And they sent it all home, and nothing changed. The parents said, again, that's cute, nice try. I love the environment too, but I like speed and efficiency even more, so no. And so the kids, you know, were a little bit downtrodden because it didn't work. It was a pretty big fail after weeks and weeks of learning and attempts. And they decided, what are we going to do to try again? Because they'd learned failing is just the beginning of learning. And so for their second attempt in learning, they looked at their environment and they said, we can't control the adults, the parents of our friends, but you know what we can control? Our school. So they removed every rubbish bin from campus. And you know what happened to all that garbage that came to school? It went right back home to mom and dad. Now, how many of you live with a small person and have ever gotten a ripe lunchbox after a long hot day? As I learned, it doesn't get to negative 40 degrees here. So that had a lot of heat to ripen and just smell delicious. And you won't be surprised that very quickly parents stopped sending garbage to school. They started sending resealable containers. Now, the other unintended learning consequence of this is that parents not only saw how impactful the rubbish that came to school was, but they also saw that when their sweet little Susie came home every day and said, "Mommy, I enjoyed that delicious and healthy lunch that you gave me oh so much, but I am quite hungry from a day of learning. May I have a snack, please?" What she was really saying was, "Mommy, I ate all the cookies out of my lunch, and now I'd like some more cookies." Because what came home in her lunch pail were the oranges, the water, the sandwich, the carrots, and the only thing that had been eaten out were the cookies. And so what the families and students were learning was that there was a serious lack of understanding not only how to keep our world healthy, but ourselves healthy. And so that learning unit turned into a whole nother learning unit about nutrition and wellness. That wasn't a problem they realized until after the kids had an attempt to look at what they were trying to do, fail, and then try a second time. And you know, it turned out great. The end of the story was the kids were happy, the teachers were happy, the parents were happy, the sheep were happy. But the thing that I took away from this lesson was, actually, I could have just heard from the great Queen Elsa of Arendelle, which is to let it go. Because as a classroom teacher, I had become a fascist dictator of my room. And I thought I was a benevolent dictator. Like, all the rules and systems and strategies I had were for the good of my people, the good of my children. I meant them no harm. But what I was doing was robbing them of choice and opportunity to truly grow. And so I took this let it go attitude back to my classroom, and it was actually perfect because as I returned to my classroom, we were being challenged to participate in a new national competition called the White House Film Festival, where President Obama challenged every student in grades K through 12 to create a 3-minute video about how technology impacted their lives. And my students said, "Absolutely, this is great, we can totally do it. We have technology, we have lives, boom, video." And as they were looking at the prompt for the video, I realized that my students were hearing a silent music every time we said video. Every time we talked about the video, they were like, "Yeah, the music video." And I'm like, "It doesn't have to be a music video." They're like, "Okay, but when we prepare for our music video." And I really wanted to say to them, "Guys, is this the best way to respond to this video prompt?" But I decided to let it go, let go of my fascist stranglehold over my classroom, and to let my kids go in the direction they wanted to go. I noticed the checklist, the rubric, was not being followed. I noticed that they were way over time. I noticed that they didn't respond to half of the things that they were supposed to do in the video. But all I did as a teacher was point them back out to their resources, encourage them, help them with the skills, and let them fail on their own, which was one of the most painful things I've ever had to do in my adult life. Now, the video that my kids created was downright catchy. I'll let you see a bit of it right now.
I'm sick of slow internet. It takes 10 years to load a page on my Chromebook. Wi-Fi don't come on my tablet. It costs too much to buy new routers. So at school we have Chromebooks, iPads, laptops, and computers. Nexus, Kindle, something even cooler. We learn here. It's a classroom and it's fun.
So guys, it's cute. I will never be able to hear Lords Royals ever again and not superimpose that those lyrics. But here's the thing. We got the letter back from the White House a few months later, and what it basically said was, congratulations, thank you for submitting, fail. And it was really hard for me to accept that and to think about how was I gonna deliver this news to my students, because you see, my kids are incredibly competitive, as I'm sure most of yours are. We have stupid competitions in our school buildings that mean absolutely nothing and you get no prizes for. For example, who can navigate the hallways to lunch the quietest? And my kids will tiptoe down to the cafeteria and they'll make it there and they'll get to the lunch monitor who has that big chart with those gold stickers and they'll look at their class names, and if that girl does not put the sticker on that, my kids lose their minds. How dare you? I didn't even breathe the whole time I came down here. So I thought, golly, if they get that salty, there's another Midwestern word for you. We've got hot mess, now salty, translate cranky. If they get that salty when they come down for lunch and don't get a gold sticker, what are they gonna get when they get a fail letter from the President of the United States? So I brought in the video that did one, which is an incredible video called Pip, about a student who utilizes technology to respond to a class project, and I showed it to my students. And I was ready for, you know, table flipping, hair pulling out, screaming, but instead, my kids were really thoughtful and really engaged by the video. And as they were whispering, they weren't conversations of, that's not fair, or why not me? The vernacular and the phrases that were coming out of their mouths were, how did he do that? And can we try it again? And I realized it was because I didn't give them that stranglehold of, this is how you have to do it, and you have to meet this exact criterion. I let them follow their hearts. And because of that, they were a little more reflective about the experience. So we decided to do it again the next year, and that year was the year that I'd seen the moonshot video, and I decided to show it to my students. And the one that really stuck out to them, the phrase or mantra that stuck out to them as a class that year, was this.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
This stuck out to my kids for two reasons. One, because as a grade 4 and grade 5 teacher, one of the things that I teach in writing is specificity of language. Don't be lazy with your language, so don't say whatever or stuff. Say exactly what you mean. And they watched that and they were like, Miss Magiera, the president got to say, we choose to go to the moon in this decade and do those other things. What are those other things? And I was like, all right, fine. But the other reason they liked it is because he said, not because it's easy, but because it's hard, our ambitions. My students' ambitions up to that point had been pretty low. When we had centers or activities, they were very canny to figure out what was the hard or the challenge activity and what was the easy one, and they'd all flock to the easy one. And they thought, who on earth would do something because it's hard? And so I said, boys and girls, all right, fine, let's try and do something hard with this video. If you could do anything, if you could be anything that seems impossible, what would your moonshot in life be? And again, I thought my kids were gonna say something like cure cancer, go to the moon, and they said, Miss Magiera, if we could be anything, anything at all, we'd be YouTube stars. And I said, what's a YouTube star? And they said, kid president.
The world needs to stop being boring. Yeah, you. Boring is easy. Everybody can be boring,
but you're gooder than that.
Life is not a game, people. Life isn't a cereal either.
Well, it is a cereal.
And if life is a game, aren't we on the same team? I mean, really, right?
I'm on your team.
Be on my team. This is life, people. You got air coming through your nose. You got heartbeat. That means it's time to do something.
So my kids are so inspired by this YouTube star kid president. If you haven't seen him, you need to. He's incredible. His name's Robbie, and there's actually, his story is even more inspiring. Unfortunately, we don't have time to quite dig into that, but Google it. It's great. You'll cry. But when I asked my kids, what do you want to do? They said, we want to create a kid president video that inspires people to do something. Well, last year's theme for the White House Film Festival was, how do you give back to your community? So my students did a survey. They sent it out to the community through QR codes, Google Forms, paper and pencil. But the overwhelming response from the children in the South Side of Chicago was, I can't change anything. I'm just a kid. My kids were irate when they saw that. They thought, what do you mean you're just a kid? We are kids with a capital K. So they wanted to create a kid president video that inspired children all around the world to believe they could, to have those higher ambitions that broke through that glass ceiling. And they said, Miss Magiera, sometimes don't you get to go to places and a bunch of grown people sit in a room and just stare at you for an hour? I said, yes, sometimes. They said, when you do those things, can you say to them, hello, teachers. I am Miss Magiera. My students are pretty cool, and they made a video for your students. I am going to show it to you right now, and I would like for you to go to your schools and show it to your students, and then ask your students to make a video and send it to my students. Thank you. Bye. I added this part at the end. But they want you to take a look at this video and listen to it as a teacher, but really look at it through the eyes of your students. At the end of the video, I'm going to give you a link, a website where you can get this, and I challenge you to show it to your students and see what they can make of it.
You know what I'm sick of? How kids seem to think just because we're not adults, we can't do anything to change them.
Just the other day, my friends and I wanted to build a robot, but they told me we can't. We're just kids.
Or some kids think that in order to make a difference, you have to be part of a group or a club that's run by an adult.
But that doesn't make any sense. Kids can do a lot. We have big ideas and big dreams, too.
I don't get why kids want to wait to grow up to do something.
When kids can do something right now.
I think some kids are scared. They think it's too hard.
So what? Do you know why JFK decided to send a man to the moon?
Not because it is easy, but because it is hard.
Here are some ways that we have decided to make changes right now.
I make a change in my community by helping take out my neighbor's garbage. I do it to help their day. I know no one don't likes touching garbage, but I do it for them anyway because it makes them smile.
I am a liturgist every first Sunday and lead them people in prayer. This brings the people in our community together and make us feel more united as one.
I do that now too. I give people a better perspective of my neighborhood by painting houses and mowing their lawn. If we can be proud of our neighborhood, it encourages people to keep it safer.
We organized our own canned food drive. We did it for people who weren't lucky enough to have their own food to eat and place to live.
And we're not the only kids taking action.
We tweeted out a question, how do you make a change in your community? And we got hundreds of answers.
Look at all these kids making a change on their own.
You can do it too. Getting started is as easy as believing you can do it and waking up deciding to take action.
So stop saying you can't just because you're a kid.
Don't wait for an adult or a club to get started.
Remember when Barack Obama was running for president?
Yep, I remember seeing a video on YouTube.
They had a slogan for him to be the first black president.
His saying was, yes, we can. Yes, we can change this world.
Yes, we can make this world a better place.
But now, I think we need to take that saying for ourselves.
For kids everywhere.
But I know that they have the power to make a difference.
No matter how small they are.
And no matter how small the change.
So hey, kids, this is our message to you.
Yes, you can.
Yes, you can.
Yes, you can.
Yes, you can.
Yes, you can. Yes, you can.
All right. right, there's the link to that video. It's actually a link to a bunch of my students' videos, this one being the first one on there. But please share it with your students. I'll tweet it out as well in case you don't quite get it, but it's bit.ly/studentsrule, all lowercase, B-I-T, bit like Charlie bit me, .ly/studentsrule. I never know if that joke's gonna play if everyone saw that YouTube video. All right, so, you know, when we're thinking about those ambitions being a glass ceiling, and both for ourselves and our kids, I wanna tell you one more story about one of my colleagues. Lindsay Rose was my student teacher. She apprenticed in my classroom for a school year and experienced a lot of this yes we can, risk-taking, and what if attitude. And so when Lindsay went into her own classroom on the South Shore neighborhood of the city of Chicago, she took on a position where she was a grade 6 maths teacher. She was really excited to have her own classroom, but her first year of teaching wasn't quite like mine. You see, the South Shore neighborhood of Chicago is known as one of the most dangerous neighborhoods in the city of Chicago. The city of Chicago is known for having, besides world-class sports teams, just kidding, we have terrible sports teams, beyond being known as the Windy City and Great Pizza, one of the things it's being known for recently is having one of the highest gun violence per capita rates in all of the United States. And South Shore neighborhood is the highest concentration of said gun violence. So if you were to read the news about South Shore Chicago, you would see articles that look like this. And the thing that is possibly the most sad about this is what it's doing to the students and families who live in this neighborhood. You see, people don't call the South Shore neighborhood South Shore. They don't talk about the fact that they have a horse stable, a golf course, beautiful lakeside views. Instead, the media refers to it blatantly as Terror Town. So imagine you're an 11-year-old who wakes up, worships, goes to school, plays, and lives and loves in this neighborhood, and it's the only neighborhood you've known your entire life. But on your way to school every day, you have to dodge news trucks and vans, sirens of people telling you, people who aren't from your community telling you that you live in Terror Town. And the kids were sick and tired of it. And every day when Miss Rose was trying to teach factors, prime factorization, polyhedra, she realized that her kids were really distracted because what they were really upset about was what happened last weekend or that news article that came out about someone they knew. So Lindsay decided to set her ambitions a little higher than simply maths, and she decided to do something nuts. As a teacher in a closing Chicago public school that was being threatened not to open the next year, in a highly impoverished neighborhood in the city of Chicago, she decided to read a book to her students. This is The House on Mango Street by Sandra Cisneros, which if you've never read it, please do. It's an amazing mentor text to talk about social change and identity and community. And she read this book with her students, and as she read it, she told her students to pull out phrases and parts of the book that meant to them, just as I did with you earlier with the moonshot video. And the students took a piece of this book and they rewrote it from their own perspective. They first sent it out via Facebook, then Twitter. It was picked up by the Chicago Sun-Times, which is one of our largest newspapers, then the Chicago Tribune, and then our national public radio. And it was broadcast across the country and even in Canada and parts of Mexico. I've been taking the video around as it's now on YouTube to share with people all around the world so that you can hear what the students of South Shore neighborhood feel about their community. But the thing that's really powerful about this was the media attention that the kids garnered for their neighborhood affected not only their one classroom in this school, but the residents of South Shore were in tears as the Sun-Times, NPR, and Chicago Tribune pulled up, saying that for the first time in almost a century, news trucks and news vans were coming to their neighborhood not to tell a story of violence and sadness, but of hope and who they truly were. And it was coming out of the mouths of their children.
We saw your news trucks and cameras here, and we read your article, 6 shot in South Shore laundromat and another mass shooting in Terror Town.
We saw the news reporters with fancy suits in front of our laundromat.
You spent 24 hours here, but you really don't know us.
Those who don't know us think this is a poor neighborhood with those abandoned buildings with the wood covering the windows and broken doors.
Those who don't know us saw the police on the corner and think that we're all violence and drugs.
They see the candy wrappers and empty juice bottles and think we don't care.
Uneducated, jobless thieves, you'll be scared of these heartless people.
When you see us coming, you might hurry up and run to your cars and lock the doors.
Then speed down these streets at 60 miles per hour like you're on a highway, trying to get out of this ghetto.
We want you to know us. We aren't afraid. We know that man at the corner. He works at the store and gives us free lemon heads.
Those girls jumping rope are Precious, Anaya, and Nivea.
The people in suits are not going to finish but to church.
That little creepy dog is Sionis, Lamar's dog.
We are the kids who find crates so we can shoot hoops.
When the sun shines here, it's not God saying he wants to burn us, but he sees us all with bright futures.
Those who know us look at the ones who want to go to college, not the ones who dropped out.
If you listen, you'll hear the laughter and chatter from the group of girls on the corner who are best friends and really care about each other.
Do you see the smile on the cashier's face when the kids walk in? Why? Because this neighborhood is filled with love.
This isn't Chirac. This is home. This is us.
Lindsay Rose could have said, "It's not my job. I'm here to teach math. It's not my job. I'm just a first-year teacher. I can't do anything. I'm going to choose not to be bothered." But Lindsay Rose looked at her students, and she heard what they were talking about when they were, quote-unquote, off task. Instead of redirecting them or hollering at them and telling them to stop talking and do more math, instead she said, "What is it that you're talking about?" She took a moment to hear them. And she said, "You know what? We're going to take some time and we're going to find a way to have your voices be heard. We spend the first 3 years of our children's lives teaching them how to walk and how to talk, and then the rest of their lives telling them to sit down and shut up." But she decided to change that. And that must have been so terrifying. I talked to Lindsay throughout this entire journey of hers, and as she was doing this, she kept saying to me, "Jennie, I'm going to get fired. Can I sleep on your couch after I get fired? I am gonna lose my job." And every day I talked to her, that was her biggest fear. And I said, "Lindsay, will it be worth it?" And she said, "No, because I gotta live." But she did it anyway. She decided to do something completely insane. So she crashed through that glass ceiling of ambition, and for her, it was a terrible risk. But she said to herself that "I can't," she kills the "I can't" out of her mindset. So I'd like for you to do me a favor in the last few minutes of this talk, and I'd like for you to take out your cell phone. Go ahead and pull it out. And I'm gonna send a basket around where you're gonna put it in the basket, and no, I'm just kidding. Donate it to the children of Chicago. No, really, take out your phone. I'm not gonna touch it or take it from you. And there's no selfies involved this time, I promise. Or social media. I'd like for you to go ahead and turn it on, and I'd like for you to open up your email app. Take a look at your email app, see which one you have. And I'd like for you to compose a new email. So we're opening our email app, we're hitting compose, we're creating a new email. And I want you to make yourself the recipient. So type your email address into the to. Some of you are like, "What's my email address?" And then I'd like for you to challenge yourself to do something nuts, something crazy, that thing that's always scared you, that you see the teacher down the hall, on TV, at the New South Wales Inspire Innovate Conference do, that you think, "I could never do that, I can't." I want you to challenge yourself to do that crazy thing. And I've asked people to do crazy things all the time. The craziest thing someone did was quit their job. I was like, "Oh my God, I am so sorry. I hope this was a good move." But I want you to challenge yourself to do that thing that you think could be truly great, but you've been holding yourself back because of fear and disbelief in yourself. And if you don't have something on the top of your mind, just write this: "Dear me, do something nuts, sincerely you." If you don't even want to type that, take a picture of the screen and email it to yourself. Go ahead and do that now. I'll give you about 30 seconds. Mood music. All right, that's enough. Okay, so hopefully you were able to hit send. But as you leave today and head to lunch, think about doing something nuts. Think about that impossibility of ambition that you weren't able to achieve. And as you're creating those moonshot ideas and deciding to set sail or lift off your spaceship, remember this. Deciding to take the moonshot is scary, but for many of us, it's not the decision to do it, but that moment right after we decide to do it that is most scary. For me, I guarantee you that if I decide to do the Sydney Harbor Bridge walk tomorrow with my husband, which I might just do just so I can tweet it and show you guys I did something crazy, I guarantee you that the moment that I'm all strapped in and I'm at the top, I'm gonna be like, what was I thinking? And that's the scariest moment when you see Earth receding behind you, everything you know, all of your fears. But here's the thing, if you can keep moving forward after you decide to do something nuts, when you land at that impossible adventure of wherever you decided to go and you look back at all of the challenges and troubles and things that stopped you, those I can'ts, they look so far away and so insignificant. Remember that your ambitions are a glass ceiling to what you can accomplish. And sometimes, in addition to all of the things that we're whinging about, our balance, our budget, our administrators, sometimes one of those things that are holding us back are ourselves. So be courageous, be adventurous, but most of all, as classroom teachers, remember that you are the front line to changing the world. So you must believe in yourselves. Thank you.